Hi, dear viewers. Thanks for another wonderful day. I'm so glad that you could connect to me today, and I'm trusting God for you and I that the time we're going to spend together, the next minute that we're going to spend together, will be a profitable one for you and I in Jesus' name. I hope you've been well, and I hope you're enjoying this season, because the best we can do is to enjoy this season. That is what we've got for now, so there's nothing we can do about it than to make the most of it. And I pray that the wisdom for you to make the most of the time we have in our hand, that heaven will grant unto you and I in Jesus' name. Before we continue in today's video, let's have a short prayer together. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we bless your name for giving us yet another wonderful privilege in your presence today. Thank you for keeping us alive. Thank you for the hope that we have in you. And the fact that we are alive, that means our hope, the hope we have in you, is still alive. So we say, blessed be your name, O Lord, in Jesus' name. We want to spend this time together encouraging and admonishing ourselves. Lord, speak to us, O Lord, from the throne of grace in Jesus' name, and give us understanding of everything you have for us today in Jesus' name. Blessed be your name, O Lord. Bless the hearers and even the speaker, O Lord, today, mightily, to the glory of your name. For in Jesus' glorious and mighty name we pray, and we receive with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Once again, God bless you. In the next minutes that we have in our hand, we shall be looking at the topic that says that five important things that money cannot provide. Yes, five important things. That is, the things that we cannot do without. We need them. The money cannot provide it for us. And as we look into the studies and believing God, that God will give us understanding. Like we said, they are important to us. So many other things that are important to us, as we run our life day to day. But, we're looking at these five important things we cannot do without. We need them daily. But unfortunately, even though money is powerful, some will say that money is so powerful, money answering all things. True, I know money is so powerful. You can imagine, if you believe money is not powerful, then pray that you will be without money. Especially in this season of lockdown and all that, people are at home. A lot of people are experiencing a lot of challenges due to lack of money. So, I'm not here to underestimate money, but the Holy Spirit is, revealing to us some things that we need. We cannot do without. And unfortunately, no matter how poor, how rich you are, if you go and break a bank, money cannot provide it for you. I pray that God will give us understanding as we look into this study. God will give us understanding as we go into the study in Jesus' name. So the number one thing on our list is peace. Yes, you heard me right, peace. If you're a Christian, you know the Bible, you will know that peace is a fruit of the Spirit. It is a fruit of the Spirit, so it's not something that you can buy off the shelf. The fruit we're talking about is not natural fruit. It's not apple or, orange or pineapple or whatever. Just name your favorite fruit that you can go to any of your local store or whatever to purchase with money. But the peace we're talking about is the peace that we need. And where do we find it? Like I said, it is the fruit of the Spirit. And it is only in God that we find peace. And look at what is going on in our world today. We need peace. In our families, we need peace. In our personal life, we need peace. You know what some people are going through behind the door, behind a closed door. Some people can come online and begin to show you pictures, begin to snap and begin to do all those things. It's camouflage. When the chips are down, to come to the reality, when they are down to themselves and nobody around them, a lot of people are miserable. They are sad, they are melancholy, just name it. They are not happy, maybe with their life or with things that is happening around them. And the only way you can come out of that is to receive the peace of God. That is it. You receive the peace of God. You need a peace. You need a peace of God. I need a peace of God. And our world today need a peace of God. Not even only because of the COVID-19. Yeah, we know that COVID-19 is what everybody is talking about now. But you know what? Even before COVID-19 comes, there's a lot of happiness in our world. There's a lot of other diseases. There's a lot of other happiness. We talk of all these young ones killing themselves through, through knife crime and all those things. It's not something that brings joy to the heart of parents, carers and authorities, hearing the news all the time that, there's an happening again, a youth or whatever, somebody has just been stabbed to death, somebody has just been gone down through a violent whatever crime. So all these things doesn't bring joy to the heart of anyone. So here we're talking about the only place we can find peace is in God himself. So let's look through the scripture and see what the scripture, what God promises us in his word. I read from the book of John 16 verse 33, and he says that these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye may have peace. In the world ye will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye may have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. That is Jesus Christ, the word of Jesus Christ himself, our Savior. Before he left his disciples, before he returned to his Father, after he finishes his mission and his, you know, his purpose on earth, he promises himself, he said, in him, it's only in him that we will have peace. He said, in this world, we will have tribulation. In this world, we will have heartbreak. In this world, we will have, you know, we will have rejection. In this world, we will have, just name it. Name it. As long as we are still in this world, we will experience all sorts of disappointment, all sorts of failures, all sorts of, you know, poverty, sickness, barrenness, whatever is it you can name that is negative. In this world, you will find it there. But if you are in this world and you are in Christ, he said, in me, you will have peace. And he said, we should be of good cheer. So no matter what is happening in our world, no matter what is happening around us, we can be rest assured that in Jesus, we will have peace. That is why we are a child of God. Not because you are not bothered about what is happening around you, but most of the time, my confidence is not what, you know, my hope and my confidence is not what, is not in what is happening around me. It's not even in the promises that the government or whoever is making. My hope is not in that. My confidence is not in that. Because if we put our hope and confidence, you know, in the world, in the policies, you know, in the laws and all that of the land and all that, we will get disappointed, we'll get frustrated, we'll get depressed. But if we put our confidence and hope in God, then in the midst, no matter what comes our way, no matter what, you know, the world or what life throws at us, we will experience peace of God. It's something, it's an inner thing that the Bible calls it the fruit of the Spirit. It comes from the Spirit of God that is living without the believer. Peace. Bible, it's likened to, it's like a river. You know, when the river is flowing, it flows. So when you have the peace of God in your heart, it flows through your heart, it flows through your marrow, it flows through your being, and you know, you are contented in any situation you find yourself. You are less bothered, you are less, you know, you care less about what is happening around you because you have the Prince of Peace, and peace, in, you know, Jesus himself, who is the Prince of Peace, living without you, within you. No matter what is happening around you, you have the Prince of Peace himself living within you. And because that Bible called that, you know, that peace, it flows like a river. It's flowing all around you. And it flows so much that it begins to outflow. It begins to flow out and affecting the life of others around you. I pray that if you are watching me and you are a child of God, that the peace of the Lord will not run dry in your life and in my life in Jesus' name. So the number one thing, like I said, is that morning, we need it. In your personal life, you need it. In my life, I need it. In our ministry, in our jobs, in our homes, in our marriages, you know, in anything we set our hands upon to do, even in the world, we can't do without peace. We cannot do without peace. But you know, the amazing thing is that it's not something you can purchase with money. You can't buy peace with money. There are times that, you know, nations are fighting against each other. They will say, oh, let's come to terms with, you know, all this peace treaty or whatever. Oh, let's make an agreement, peace deal and all that. Oh, Palestinian and the Australians and the this and that. And before you know it, the peace they promise themselves, some of them are so frightened that it doesn't even last within 24 hours. Before you know it, they are back again to war. They are back again. The trouble starts again. It can be temporal. A leader can tell you, oh, maybe America is saying I'm signing a peace treaty with maybe it's not North Korea or whichever. Just pick two nations that you know that at times they are always at, you know, at loggerhead with each other, or maybe it's Russia or whoever. The next minute they will tell you they are, you know, they've agreed to some terms and all that, there's going to be peace. And the next moment again, before you know it, one of them will break, you know, because there is no peace in this world. The only place we can find peace that lasts is in Jesus. And I pray that we will hide ourselves in him so that the peace of God will not elude you and I in Jesus' name. Also, if we look at the scripture, if we look at Leviticus 26 verse 6, Leviticus 26 verse 6, It says, and I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down. Amen. God is promising us. He said he will give peace. He is the only one that can give. He's the giver of peace. When he promises, he brings it to pass. He said, I will give peace in the land, and you will lie, and you shall lie at peace, and none shall make you afraid. And I will rid evil beasts out of the land. Neither shall the sword go through your land. And I say a very big amen to that. God is promising us. He said he will give peace. He is the only one that can promise. I can promise you, I'll give you peace. Your president, your prime minister, your governor, the governor of your state, your counselor, your MP, your senator, whoever it is, even your family, your parents cannot promise you peace because they have as much as is given to them themselves. The peace they have is for themselves, but they can use it and, you know, it can reflect around them. But the only person that can guarantee that he can give peace is God himself through his spirit that is living within us. And I pray that we'll continue to enjoy the peace of God in our homes, in our life, and in our land. God is promised, he said he will give peace in the land. He said, I will give peace in the land. That's the word of God. And God is faithful to his promise. He said, I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you to be afraid. And the Lord promises, he said, he will rid evil beasts out of our land. Neither shall the sword go through our land again in Jesus' name. Every sword that is going through our land, every pestilence, every beast that is going through our land, the Lord will see, you know, the power of God will bring them to, you know, to a standstill. And God will make his peace to reign in our lives and in our hearts in Jesus' name. You know, we have other Bible references that we cannot read because of the time. And we'll go to the next one. The next important thing that we need, that unfortunately money cannot provide for us, is joy. The next important thing that we need, very important for us on a daily basis, the money, unfortunately, no matter how rich you are, you can't buy it on the shelf. You can't buy it online. You know, you can't get it on a deal, no matter how expensive or how cheap you think it might be. You can never be the richest man on earth. Joy is of the Lord. Happiness, yes, can be purchased. The peace of God, you cannot purchase it. It is not available. You can only find it in God. So if you need it, you hide yourself in God, and you will enjoy it to the fullest in Jesus' name. We need the joy of the Lord. We need the joy of the Lord. And we'll see what the Bible tells us about the joy of the Lord. Like I said, it's the fruit of the Spirit. You can only find it in God and nowhere else. I read from the book of Psalm 16:11. Psalm 16:11 says, thou will show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. Not just any joy now, but the fullness of the joy. The fullness of joy is in the presence of God. And at your right hand, there are pleasures evermore. The psalmist is saying that God will show him the path of life. Because in the presence of God is fullness of joy. Joy that you know, that runs to overflow. But it says fullness. I mean, something that overflows. Fullness of joy can only be found in the presence of God. So, it's not a matter of somebody will say, but now that we don't go to church, so I cannot find joy. You don't have to be in the church to enjoy the presence of God. Because if you're a child of God, you're a carrier of the presence of God yourself. Because Bible tells us that God dwells within us, the Spirit lives within us. So if you are a child of God, if I'm a child of God, the Spirit of God is living within you. That means you're a carrier of the joy of the Lord. So if at any time you are not finding yourself being joyous, you realize that I'm not joyful. What is going on? That means you are missing part of the fruit of the Spirit of God. And if you are conscious of that, it's good that you know. All you need to do is to ask God, say, Father, I know you are within me. I know you live within me. I want to experience your joy. Let your joy overflow. Let it flow within me. It is of the Lord. It is the gift of God. It is the, you know, it is the gift of the Spirit that we cannot buy it. It's not something we can purchase. We don't beg for it. It is part of our privilege of being children of God, because the day you give your life to Jesus, the Spirit of God begins to live within you, and his fruit begins to germinate in our hearts, and that is part of the fruit. As long as God is living within you, Bible says that in the presence of God is fullness of joy. So if the presence of God in my life brings about the fullness of joy of the Lord, that is why in poverty, in riches, in sickness, in everything, I am joyful. Because I have the joy of the Lord within me. And I pray that the joy of the Lord that you and I have, that nothing, no power of hell will be able to take it away from us in Jesus' name. If nobody can take God away from you, then nobody can take your joy. And nothing will take your joy away in Jesus' name. So the joy of the Lord can only be found in the presence of the Lord. And that presence of the Lord is within you. Amen. Because the Spirit of God is within you. Hallelujah. I read Psalm 51 verse 12. And it says, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit." Restore, that's the psalmist praying in a time of challenge. So because there was a problem, you know, here, and King David said, after he has fallen, after King David has fallen into sin, he knew that he cannot be living in sin and be experiencing the joy of the Lord. He cannot be living in sin and be expecting the presence of God to still abide with him. He knows there that he has lost the presence of God. So that is one thing that we should be mindful of. If we want to experience the joy of the Lord, we make sure that we live a holy. That is that we should make our body, we should keep our body holy. We should present our body as a living sacrifice unto God, holy and acceptable unto him. That is our reasonable service. But under this circumstance, David, he fell from grace. That was when, you know, he sinned and he, you know, he committed adultery with Bathsheba. So that time, he lost the presence of God. Most of the verdict of God has, you know, came to him through Prophet Nathan. So at that time, David came to terms with the reality. He knows that he has lost the joy of the Lord. He has lost the presence of God. Somebody cannot lose the presence of God and be experiencing joy of God. It is not possible. That would be contradictory. To experience the joy of the Lord, you must have the indwelling of the presence of God within you. It is the presence of God within you that supplies the joy of the Lord. You can't have one without the other. You can't have joy of the Lord without the presence of God. And you cannot have the presence of God without the joy of the Lord. It is not possible. So they go, pari passu, both of them, they are together. So King David prayed here. He was honest with himself and with God. So at times we need to be honest with ourselves. We can deceive people, but we cannot deceive ourselves, and we can't deceive God. For us to enjoy the presence and the fruit of the Spirit of God, God, we must not grieve the Spirit of God, and we should make sure that God is still abiding in us. And if we have polluted ourselves, if we have wronged God, if we have sinned, we know that definitely God cannot indwell a filthy vessel. God indwells an holy vessel. Hallelujah. So we have to make sure that for us to continue to enjoy the presence and the joy of the Lord, we keep ourselves holy. We keep ourselves, you know, we make ourselves, you know, an acceptable vessel for God to indwell. And I pray that God will purge you and I of every filthiness, everything is it that might want to contradict, or that might want to, you know, to not allow the presence of God, to that will make the presence of God to be unabated, that will not allow the presence of God to be unbeatable in our life. God will remove them by his power in Jesus' name. So in Psalm 51, King David was honest. He said, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with your free spirit." And I pray today, if you are watching me, anybody that you have lost the presence of God, you've lost the joy of the Lord, you've lost the joy of your salvation, I pray that the mercy of God will bring about restoration, will bring about repentance first, because you need to first amend your ways before God can indwell you again. The Spirit can come back to you. Just like David humbled himself and he accepted that he has lost the joy of his salvation. He needs God. It is God that is bringing about joy and bringing about, you know, a difference in his life. He needs the presence of God again. And after he has done that, then definitely God is faithful and is merciful. He said, whosoever confesses the sin, he said, he will experience pardon. He will obtain pardon of the Lord. So God, I'm sure, after some time, bring about restoration and healing again. And I pray that if you are watching me and you have lost the joy of your salvation, heaven will remember you for good. It will bring about repentance. It will bring about, you know, you will restitute your way so that you'll be able to enjoy the joy of the Lord again in Jesus' name. Amen. And the next important thing that we need, that money cannot provide for us, is faith. We can't buy it. It happens also that faith is part of the fruit of the Spirit. We can't buy faith. It's of the Lord. It's the gift of God. It's the fruit of God. And we can enjoy it also when we have the presence of God in our heart. So the question is, are you a carrier of the presence of God? If you're saying, "No, I don't have enough faith. My faith is dwindling." Yes, it's acceptable. You cannot be a child of God and be saying that you don't have faith. For you to have confessed that you are a child of God, then that means you believe in the first place that God is God. That's why you call yourself a child of God. So if you have a child of God, you have the faith enough to believe that God is who he says he is. Then you will need enough faith also to be able to walk with God. Because by the way, without faith, we can't walk with God. We can't please God without faith. So we need faith. But unfortunately, it's not something that we can buy. It's unsellable, not sellable. We can't purchase it. Nobody can get it for us. My parents cannot give me their own faith. They can lead me in the path of life. I can encourage my children in the path of life. But my own faith is got to be personal, that I will get from God. It's a personal thing. Faith is personal. It is the gift of God, but individually we must receive it on behalf of ourselves. I can't receive faith for you. You can't receive it for me. I can't receive it for my children. My husband cannot receive for me. I can't receive for my husband. It's a personal thing. It's a personal gift from above, and we receive it by faith. We receive it by ourselves, and we make it applicable to ourselves. It's a free gift. We don't need money to buy it. And we need it. Because Bible says that without faith, we can't please God. From the book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, he said that, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. For if you come to God as a child of God, if you want to walk with God, if you want to serve God acceptably, if you want to do the will of God, you want to know the mind of God, you need faith. Even you want to receive from God, you want to receive answers to your requests and all that, you need faith. To work with God daily, we need faith. And we all have faith. But the question is that where is your faith? In whose, or in what do you put your faith? Where is your faith placed? Is it placed in man or is it placed in God? We need faith. And because without it, we cannot please God. Without faith, we can't please God. But unfortunately, we can't buy it. So how do we receive faith then? Because Bible just told us in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 that without faith, it is impossible for us to please God without faith. We can't come to him, we can't deal with him without faith. So how do we receive faith? That's the question. Like I said, it's a gift of the Spirit. But how do we receive the faith of God? If I read from the book of Romans chapter 10 verse 17, Romans 10:17, it says, so then faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. As you are hearing me now, the word of God should be stirring up your faith within you. If there's any area that you are doubting over a particular matter, and you hear the word of God coming forth to you, all you need to do is to apply faith and believe. Faith is believing. You can't buy it. I remember I find myself in an assembly some years ago. You know, as a family, we were having some challenges, you know, very difficult time. While we were still in London, very difficult. When I meant difficult, I meant difficult then, you know. And we needed, you know, divine intervention. But thank God, you know, for the Spirit of God that was living within me. I heard of a ministry that, you know, well, I saw on the TV, and I saw the minister that, this man, he seems harmless and all that. Not because I have a church that was attending. But he just felt, this man is preaching the gospel. He's harmless. Let me give it a try and see what happens. We went there. I went very early and all that. Not to bore you with the story. But one thing I realized is that while we were waiting for us to see the minister of God, something provoked my spirit within me. One of the ministers, while we're waiting to see the man of God, one of the ministers, you know, that was talking to us while we're seated, he said something. He said, in this ministry, you come here, you know, whatever you come here, where the man of God pray for you, you know, everything will be gone. You will go to some churches, they'll be telling you to exercise faith, to do this, to do that, and all that. No, we don't do that here. You just come here and just receive an answer and go. My spirit does not agree with it. You ask me why. Before I went there, I'm a child of God. You know, many of us at times when we're going through challenges, when I meet challenges, you know, there are challenges and there are challenges. That is the reality. It looks as if we need an immediate answer. As if that answer doesn't come, as if the world is coming to our head. The world is crushing down on you, so you need an immediate answer. So while that man was standing there, I saw him as if he was speaking. As far as I'm concerned, with a little walk, then that, you know, I've walked with God, even as a then, I don't see that word corresponding with the word of God. You know why? The Bible says that we, you know, without faith we can't please God. So how can you now be telling me that we don't need faith? When somebody just comes to your ministry, the man of God just pray, and they'll be, even without you believing, when the man of God pray for you, how do you receive? You cannot receive anything from God without believing. Bible says, even if your faith is as tiny as a mustard seed. So is it that the man was blaspheming? Or he doesn't even know what he was talking about? To them, they were selling their products. To them, they were advertising. I don't know what he was up to. But to me, you know, whatever is it that he was trying to sell, it was not for me. That day, coupled with some other things, I decided to leave the ministry. I left there without seeing the man of God, with some other, you know, elements that they were introducing and all. I said, and I have to ask God for forgiveness, to be honest. I have to ask God. I said, God, you have to forgive me. I would rather wait. I will rather wait on you. There's nothing wrong with me exercising my faith. Because I learned in my scripture that, you know, without faith we can't please God, and without faith we can't even see God. I can't see God without faith. So I would rather wait on you. And you know what? God did not answer me immediately, but he gave me the grace to wait on him. Beloved, there are times that you just need the grace of God to wait on God to do what he has promised you to do. When God promises, he brings it to pass, because he's not a man that he will lie. Neither is he a son of man that he will repent. The Bible says that as he said it and not done it. 1, 2, 3 years later, the answer did not come. But he gave me the grace. He gave me the strength to be able to wait on him. Did I regret leaving the ministry? No. Because each time, you know, the Lord is asking me to wait for him, he's strengthening me in faith. He's taking me, he's maturing me, he's working on me. It's because I'm not serving God because I just want to receive from God, but I'm serving God because God is God. So if you find yourself under any ministration, you find yourself anywhere, and somebody is telling you that you don't need faith to walk with God, I want to believe that the spirit of Antichrist is in that person. Is it that the person is blaspheming, or the person himself needs to go back again to Calvary, or needs to go back and search the scripture? We need faith, and we can't buy it. We only receive it through hearing the word of God. So if you want to rekindle your faith, start now studying the scripture. Start now listening to genuine and sincere servants of God that have the word of life. People that are ready to preach the gospel in season and out of season. They are ready to bring the word of God to you without fearing your faith, without looking at you, looking at the face of the people, and you know, they are not afraid of men, but they are afraid of him that has sent them. Servants of God that are ready to contend for the gospel, for the word that was once given unto the saints. Those are the people you should be listening to. And we still have few of them. They are not everywhere, they are not common, but we still have few of them. You listen to the word of life that will give you life, that will rekindle your hope, that will make you to know that whether God does what he decides to do, what he promises to do or not, that does not stop him from being God. We see a lot of scriptures in the Bible. If you read the book of Hebrews, you will see it's a hall of faith. You know, it's a hall of faith for believers that have gone ahead of us. Crowd of witnesses that have gone ahead of us. These people, they walk with God by faith. Many of them, the Bible recorded that they did not receive even till they die. Many of them believe to death. So faith is about believing, but you can't buy with money. I pray that God will give you understanding. And as you hear the word of God today, it will rekindle your faith. And it will make you to trust God and believe in for who he says he is. And to make you to realize that God, you know, you need faith. You need faith, no matter how small it is, to walk with God acceptably. Before I leave that point, I'll read from the book Luke 18:8. It says, "Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth?" That is Jesus Christ saying that when he come again, even though we need faith, he knows that we need him to see him. even when he returned, because he's coming back again. So will he find faith on the earth? Will he find faithful people that are waiting in faith, that are believing and hoping, you know, trusting when he come? It's a question for you and I, that when the Son of Man shall come, will he find faith on the earth? But I'm believing God for you and I, that God will find us faithful when he shall come again. He will find you faithful. He will find me faithful. He will find us in the faith. We will not depart from the faith. We will not listen, you know, to blasphemers. We will not listen to false prophets. We will not listen to the wrong voices that will make us to depart from the faith that we have received in Jesus' name. We need the faith of God. We need the faith of God to walk with God. And I pray that God will grant it afresh to you and I, as we receive the word of God, as we make up our mind to study the word of God and to meditate on it, not just studying it, but also to meditate and reflect upon the word of God, our faith will be rekindled. We need to be intentional about it. We need to find time and spend time in the presence of God for our faith to be rekindled. And I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. Lastly, on that point, I read from the book of Luke 22, verse 32. And it says, "But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not." That is Jesus Christ himself praying. He said, even though he's wondering that when he come back on earth, he's not sure whether he's going to meet faith on earth, but he's praying for us. He's praying for you and he's praying for me. He said, "But I've prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren." My beloved, when your faith is rekindled, when it's renewed, strengthen your fellows. Brothers and sisters, strengthen your brethren. That is what I've come here to do today, to strengthen your faith. And I pray that our faith will be strengthened in Jesus' name. Fourth important thing that we need, that money cannot buy for us, is a godly home. A godly home. I can say a home, I can say a godly home. But because I believe I'm speaking to, you know, to children of God, and if you're not a child of God, you're watching me, just keep watching. Don't change the dial. Don't touch the dial. Don't touch your phone. Just keep listening. The Spirit of God has brought you here for a purpose, and it will fulfill it, you know, the purpose in your life in Jesus' name. Money can buy you a home, not to talk of a godly home. Money can build you mansions. It can build you castles. It can take you even to the moon, because for you to even go to the moon, you know how expensive that would be. You can build the best house upon the surface of the earth. You can live in an estate. You can live, you know, or, you know, on an island. You can live because of the money you have. But you know what? That is a house. But behind a closed door, what is happening there? A house and a home is different. A home is where you are always longing to be. A home is where you will be, and you will experience the peace and the joy and love and tranquility. Tranquility, you will enjoy, you know, just name it. That is a home, most especially when you talk in godly home, where God himself is the chief cornerstone, where God himself is the foundation and the bedrock. Money can buy it. If money can buy it, we will not be seeing the rate of divorce that we are seeing in our world. If money can buy it, even people that say that they are married, many of them, they are living together, they are just enduring themselves. Many of them, they are living together for status, so that they will say that I'm still married, I'm a married man, I'm a married woman, but they don't have a home. But I'm believing God for you and I, that as you watch me today, as you hear this word today, that if your home is troubled, if you are living in a house, not a home, that the mercy of God will locate you and your home, and it will revisit every shaky foundation. Everything that the enemy has planted in your home, the mercy of God will approach it in Jesus' name, and will bring about healing. Will bring about, you know, divine reconstruction into your home and into your life in Jesus' name, so that you will see God glory, you will see God light, you know, radiating in your home, and your home will be a beacon of light to others in the mighty name of Jesus. Money can buy you a house. There's no doubt about it. Money can buy you a house, but it can never buy you a home. It can never. That only can be provided by the mercy and by the Spirit of God. It takes somebody that has the Spirit of God and the fear of God to build a home. You say, okay, so that kind of home doesn't mean that they won't have a misunderstanding. Probably they might have misunderstanding, but they do all things in the fear of God. They do all things under the wisdom and under the guidance of God. They do all things under the watchful eyes of God. That kind of a husband, they can leave the home on assignment for 1-2 months and the wife is not worried. That kind of wife, he can go to work, he's not panicky and begin to check, calling the maid or calling the children, where is your dad? What's your daddy doing? What's he watching? No. The children can leave the home and the parents are not afraid because they know that everyone has the fear of God in them. It takes the fear of God to build a home and it takes the Spirit of God, you know, to manage the home. And I pray, like I said before, that the mercy of God will locate. If you are watching me and you know that what you have is a house, you don't have a home. It does not matter the impression that people have about you outside. You know, some people, they are actors. Actors and actresses. You can even see in our own culture, and I believe they do it in the Western world too. You can see people going out, you know, dressed in the same color. In the Western world, they wear the same shade of clothing. But where, you know, in Africa, where I came from, they will wear the same regalia, they wear the same outfits. You know, the same material, they will sew it for them. But many of them, back home, they do that for camouflage. They will do it so that people will think, oh, the best couple on earth. Some of them will post their pictures online. I've seen enough of all those nonsense. That's why you have to be careful what you wish for. I've seen the situations where people say, I wish I had a home like that. You better be careful what you wish for because you don't know what is behind the door. What is going on behind the door? Some of them, maybe for months, they've never spoken to each other. Some of them, maybe the wife doesn't even cook for the husband at all. Many of them, the husband is a wife beater. And you will see them and you'll be wishing. You better don't wish for bad things. Wish for a home where God, you know, will be the head. Anything you want to wish for a home where God himself will be the head, where Jesus will be your example. Stop using men, I'm sorry to say. Because you don't know. You don't know what is happening behind the door. So many called ministers of God, so many pastors, they come to church. On their driving to church, they didn't even speak with their wife. They're keeping manners. For weeks, they've not spoken. Some of them, they didn't even drop money for housekeeping at home. But you see them deck, you see them, you know, clad in suits, clad in the wife too, wearing hats, all the, you know, you will think all this way. I'm not here to speak. That is the truth. Be careful what you wish. Be careful what you wish, because if you're saying that you're wishing to be like a particular couple or to be like a particular, your home to be, you know, to be modeled or patterned after a particular home, and their home is a turbulent home, then they are giving you, they are only seeing you, the more you look, the less you see. They are giving you what they want you to see. That means you are wishing evil for yourself. I think God will give us wisdom. If I were you, you will pray that God will give you a home, that Christ is the head, that Christ is the chief cornerstone. But I'm believing God also, that God will begin to visit our homes as believers, that our home will be what God had in mind. The intention of God for our homes will be fulfilled. We will not be hypocrites. We will not be deceiving ourselves. We will not be something else outside that will be coming out to portray something. It's hypocrisy. Let's deal with it. If there's any problem in our home, let's deal with it with the mercy of God. And I pray that the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Yes, God will help us. God is a rebuilder, is a restorer of bridging walls, He's a restorer of bridges. God will restore every bridges, every loophole that we have created in our families, in our homes. Every home also that every family that we've set up based on, you know, on worldly standard, that we ended up with a house, not a home. Even some children will look at their parents and be saying, if this is the way marriage is all about, I don't even want to get married. I pray that will not be our standard. God will have mercy in Jesus' name. So a home can only be built by God. You can't buy it. Money cannot buy it. Why the richest person, the most influential person in the world cannot give you a home? They can only give you a house. And time will tell. Time will tell. Even if you manage and you keep on tagging along, like they used to say, you tag along and tag along, you are deceiving yourself. You can't deceive God. Because where will he hand you? I pray that God will give us understanding in Jesus' name. I read from the scripture. I read from the book of 2 Samuel 13. 2 Samuel chapter 13. In fact, if you read the whole of 13 further, you will see, you know, the sin that King David sinned brought about a kind of curse upon his family. That Amnon, one of his sons, had to be sleeping with his sister, Tamar. They are sleeping with themselves, killing themselves one after the other because of sin. This is a king that built a house, built a castle, built all sorts of things, but he could not build a home. I pray that God will give us wisdom, that we will live our life based on the wisdom of God and the fear of God. And our home, our families will be a home where God dwells. God himself will indwell our families in Jesus' name. You know, the children turning against one another through deception and through all sorts of things because of the sin of the parents. I pray that God will bring mercy and will bring healing in the mighty name of Jesus. I read from the book of Luke 6. Luke 6, 47 to 49. And it says, whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built an house and digged deep. He didn't just build the house according to the standard of the world. He built the house and he digged deep and laid the foundation on a rock, which is Jesus himself. That is when you have a home. When for the foundation is Jesus, then you have succeeded in building a home. I pray that God will give you wisdom. You will keep on digging deep. You will not just build a house. You will not just buy a lovely castle. Just build it, you know, according to the architectural design of the world. But you will dig deeper. Through the wisdom and the word of God and the counsel of God, everything you need to do, you will keep on digging deeper until you reach that rock, which is Jesus himself. He said, it's like a man which built an house and dig deep and laid a foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation build an house upon the heads, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. I pray that our home will not be ruined. Challenges will come. Difficulties will come. Temptation will come. But what will make, will differentiate a house from a home will be dependent upon what foundation, you know, you built upon. When you are getting married, upon what foundation are you building upon? Is it upon riches, upon fame, upon influence, upon beauty? Just name it. You will be like him, like that man in verse 49, that built upon the heads, no foundation. He never bothered to dig deep. God will give you understanding. And I pray that the mercy of God will visit every family and will bring down to naught every wrong foundation, so that Christ himself will be enthroned in every home, so that the peace of God will reign in our families, so that no matter the pressure, no matter the shaking, no matter the wind or the storms, no matter the turbulence that might come, we shall stand. And our homes and our families, you know, will be an example in our world and for the world to come in Jesus' name. Did I hear you say amen to that? And so shall it be in Jesus' name. I read also from the book of Psalm 127 verse 1. And it says, except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord himself build you a home. They use a house here. But the truth is that except God himself is the builder, they labor in vain that are building it. I pray that you and I will not labor in vain in Jesus' name. We ask for the wisdom, we ask for the leading and the guidance of the Lord as we build, so that our labor will not be in vain in Jesus' name. And our last point, which is number 5, of the important things that we need, that money cannot provide. It is the most important. Without this last point, every other thing is in vain. It's salvation. Salvation of our soul. It can't be purchased with money. It is the gift of God. Salvation. You need it. I need it. And if you already have it, I thank God for your life. I pray that you will keep it till you see God face to face in Jesus' name. It is the gift of God. Because the scripture tells us clearly that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He gave. He didn't say that he sold his only begotten son. He didn't say that he borrowed his only begotten son. He didn't say that he hired his only begotten son. He didn't say that he loaned his only begotten son. He gave his only begotten son. It's a gift of God. It's free of charge. That whosoever believe in him should not perish but have eternal life. So the question is that, have you received the gift? It is free and you need it. You know why? For you to, because by the time you move from here, this temporal place of abode, which is the head, is temporal, and you move to the life beyond, salvation will determine where you end. If you are saved, that means you will end eternally with God the Father. Because Jesus Christ said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Jesus himself is the way to the Father. He is the truth and the life. He is the way that you will take to the Father in heaven. So without you going through Jesus, you can't get to God. It does not matter what you believe before. It does not matter your impression. It does not matter your understanding of getting to God. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. And it is free of charge. It is gift. It is a gift of God. And I pray that you open your heart today. You will receive this gift. While you still have breath within you, while you still have the opportunity, and if you have received it, you will keep on walking. The scripture says that you will daily work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Even though you've received it as a free gift, you will not daily work it out. Daily work out as you are doing exercise to keep yourself fit. You will not daily work it out with fear and trembling in Jesus' name. You will not lose it. No power of hell will take it away from you. Then you must be intentional about it. You must keep yourself in the fear of the Lord to keep it, and you will not lose it in Jesus' name. I read from the book of Ephesians 2. I read from Ephesians 2 from verse 8 to 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man boast of it. You and I, we are saved by grace, by the grace of God. That is that the grace of God has appeared unto all men, warning us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, that we should depart from every sinful ways. We should live soberly and godly in this present world. And I pray that the grace for us to live soberly through the grace that we have received, not the grace that you received and you believe that it is a liberty for you to continue to walk in sin and to continue to walk in iniquity. When the scriptures have already told you that if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. That all the whole things you've done is gone and everything has become new. But if you are still entangling yourself again with your whole life, you are like a dog that has come back into his vomit. You are telling God that you don't need his grace. You are telling God that the sacrifice of Christ is not needful. You don't need it. You should keep it. But I pray that will not be your testimony in Jesus' name. It's a free gift of God. It is a free gift of God. You can't purchase it with money. You don't even have what it takes to buy it. For the grace of God, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It is a free gift. You don't buy it with money. So if you go to any ministry and they're telling you that before you receive salvation, you have to pay this, you have to do that, tell them to keep it. Go back to your closet and call to God in prayer and tell him to forgive you your sin. And he will come into your heart there and then. And it will save you, and you become a new creature. So don't pay anybody. Don't believe any minister or any preacher that tells you that before you can see God, you have to do this and do that. It's a lie. It's a deceiver. It's a false prophet. Stay away from such. And I pray that God will separate you from such in Jesus' name. And not of works, lest any man boast of it. So you can't boast of it. I didn't do anything to earn salvation. It is the free gift of God. And I pray that we will not take it for granted in Jesus' name. And I read also from the book of Matthew 10, verse 8, it says, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out the devils. Freely you receive, freely give. So the Bible says that we should heal the sick, we should cleanse the lepers. Anybody that is sick, lay hands on them. We receive from God freely. The gift of God, the Holy Spirit of God is free. Freely we receive, freely gift. It's one of the reasons why I said the ministry I went then in London, they're telling me to buy this and buy that and buy. Before I can buy this, if I go to the minister of God, he will not preach to me. He will not pray for me. He will not lay hands on me. And I said, and I know the word of God. God forbid. Let the problem remain. At God's appointed time, he will answer my prayer. We cannot godly, we cannot, because of desperation, sin against God. Because of temporary answer. Many people, in fact, have even allowed people to bring into their life even more problem. Imagine somebody that runs to a place because of headache and leave the place with epilepsy or with any, just name it, or with cancer. Through is somebody that called themselves a servant of God and they had more problem to their life. I pray that God will have mercy and deliver us from running helter skelter. Wait on the Lord. He will do what he promises to do. He is a faithful God and he promises to make everything beautiful in his time. The greatest gift we can receive from God is salvation. If God can save you, he will heal you. Amen? If God can save me, he will heal me. If God can save me, he will deliver me. The greatest blessing we can receive from God is the gift of salvation. Because you know why? Somebody can be healed and still go to hellfire if he's not saved. Somebody can be the richest person. You are believing God for breakthrough, financial breakthrough, and you get answer. For what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul in hell? So, even though we need help, we need deliverance, there are times that we have pressing issues. You've been waiting upon the Lord for fruit of the womb. You've been waiting for life partner. Wait on the Lord. That is that he will make everything beautiful in his time. And if for any reason the answer did not come, it will come in Jesus. If it did not come, hold on to God. Hold on to the Lord. As long as you don't lose your soul. As long as you are sure that when you live here, there's a greater comfort for us in heaven. It's there in the book of Hebrews 11. There are so many that walk with God. Believe him. Even then, they didn't know that what they were exercising was faith. It is after they are gone that they are now being recognized as people of faith. When they were living their life, they were just believing and holding on for deliverance, holding on to God for help, holding on to God for favor, holding on to God for breakthrough, holding on to God for healing. It never happened. But the greatest comfort and consolation is that they meet with their maker, they made heaven. I pray that you and I will make heaven. We will not trade our eternity with God, with temporary and ephemeral things in Jesus' name. God will give us wisdom. Everything the Lord has given us, we will cherish it. We will hold on to it. We will not lose it. In Jesus' name, we will not fall into temptation. The tempter of our soul will not exchange. Will not be like Esau that traded his birthright for a pot of porridge. He finished eating, then his eyes were open. We will not trade our birthright. We will not sell our salvation. We will not lose the joy of our salvation. We will not lose the joy of the Lord. We will not lose the peace of God. The peace of God will not depart from our life. And we will not lose the faith we have in God in Jesus. If you are watching me, and all these things that I listed, remember I said at the beginning that there are important things that we need. Whether you're a believer or non-believer, we need it. For us to live acceptably, to live victoriously, we daily need these things. But do you have it? You can't have it if you don't have God in your life. You need God. You need God. And like I said before, that you cannot go to God. You cannot access God. You cannot reach God without through Jesus. You need Jesus into your life. Through him, you reach out to God. Through him, you have access to God 24/7. His lines are always open. There's no internet interruption. There's no network problem. If you're happy to accept God into your life through his son, Jesus Christ, close your eyes and let us pray this prayer together. By faith, you say this prayer after me. Dear Lord, thank you for sending your son to come and die for my sin and for the sin of the world. I humble myself before you and I acknowledge that I need you. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me of my unrighteousness and give me the grace to sin no more. Write my name in the book of life so that I will begin to have victory and begin to walk with you acceptably from today onward. Thank you for the answer prayer, and thank you for saving me. For in Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. I rejoice with you, my beloved, my sister or my brother. If you have just prayed this prayer with sincerity of heart, God is forgiving your sins. And Jesus himself has taken over your life. He's now the Lord of your life, and he's taking the Lordship over your soul. He begins to lead you and guide you by his Spirit. I rejoice with you. And there is celebration in heaven because of you, for what you have just done. And I pray that what you have done today, you will look back and you will thank God for this moment. And as you receive faith, salvation by faith, as you receive salvation by faith today, every other thing also that you are believing God for, heaven will supply them in Jesus' name. You will not serve God in vain. You will not believe God in vain. And you will not hold on to God in vain in Jesus' name. In every area that the devil has been molesting and manipulating you, from this day, heaven will begin to fight your cause and grant you victory in Jesus' name. I rejoice with you once again. The Bible says that if you're in Christ, you're a new creature. Today is a new beginning in your life. It's a day that you have just been born again. You have become a baby in the Lord. And for you to survive, just like a natural baby, you need milk, which is the word of the Lord now. You need to make time to survive as a baby, to grow. You need the word of God. That's why we say that faith coming by hearing, Romans 10:17, by hearing the word of God. Make time to study the word of God. And I pray that God will give you understanding. The Spirit of God himself will guide you into all truths in Jesus' name. And I encourage you to find yourself a Bible-believing church. That might be a little bit difficult because of the lockdown around the world at the moment. But I pray that as soon as things normalize, the Spirit of God will lead you to the rightful place where you will worship with the sons and daughters of God so that you'll be able to grow. That is that we should not forsake the assembly of one another. And I also encourage you to join me here regularly. As the Lord gives the grace, we grow together, we encourage ourselves, we admonish ourselves in the word of the Lord. And as we do that, the Lord will continue to increase and strengthen you and I in Jesus' name. Thank you, everyone, for being part of today's. I believe you've been blessed. If you have been blessed, like the video, comment below, you know, and share with somebody to be a blessing to somebody. And if you are watching me, that maybe today is your first time, or you've been watching, you are yet to subscribe to this channel, please, I encourage you to subscribe to this channel. You know, subscribe and click the bell button beside the subscribe button, which says it's a bell icon. It's the notification button. It will notify you whenever I upload a new video. And I believe God for you, that as we study together, the grace of God will continue to abound in every life in Jesus. Remember that I love you, that Jesus loves you more. I look forward to seeing you in my next video. God bless you. Bye for now.